worship the Lord this morning. So I want to read out a passage from 1 Kings, and it's Elijah when he's in the middle of a battle with the prophets of Baal. And the challenge is that they're going to put out a sacrifice, both of them, and whichever God answers with fire is the true God. And before he does that, he dumps water all over the altar just to make it harder. And then he prays this prayer. Answer me, Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, Lord, are God and that you are turning their hearts back again. And of course, we know that Yahweh, the one true God, came down and consumed the sacrifice. And so I just want us to think as we sing this morning, as we worship this morning, that we are worshiping the same God who did miracles back then and that he can do miracles today. He's the same God. Is anything too hard for the Lord? It's Genesis 18. Is anything too hard for him? Just keep that in mind as we sing this morning.
He calls. I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure. I'll praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm numbered. I'll praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the waters my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise.
We've gathered, isn't it? To worship God and worship his holy name together. One of the ways that the Lord tells us to worship him is to remember him. and to remember him through the taking of communion. And so we've got some servers who are going to come. I would invite them to start. Everyone else could be seated. Communion is really described as a family meal. This is a remembrance, the bread and the cup, for everyone who is a part of the family of God, and that is possible through faith in Jesus Christ. So for everyone who would say, yes, Jesus Christ is my Lord, this is for you. If you're not at that place yet, you've not made that commitment, I would encourage you to let these elements pass you by today, but to take the time and to consider what would it take for me to turn by faith from my sins and to turn by faith to Jesus Christ as Savior. That's a wonderful thing to think about. And as you're thinking about that, Matthew 11 says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So now we're going to take a few moments and worship and pass the elements and then just hold them. And together then as a church family, we'll remember the Lord here in just a couple of moments. Christ's sacrifice for us, what we recognize is that he overcame the biggest dividing thing we had. It was our sin that kept us from a holy God. And when you come to faith in Jesus Christ, you do come into his family. And in his family, there's a transcendence of nations and tribes and tongues, and it doesn't matter what your background is, your future is, I belong to Jesus Christ. So even as we come to communion today, we're going to reflect that and remind ourselves of that by coming to the Lord's table both in English and in Spanish. Thankfully, I have help on the Spanish part. Come Come on, Edgar. And so we just want to remember the Lord together because we are one church family. So Edgar, why don't you begin?
La noche en que fue traicionado, el Señor Jesús tomó pan y dio gracias a Dios por ese pan. Luego lo partió en trozos y dijo, esto es mi cuerpo, el cual es entregado por ustedes. Hagan esto en memoria de mí.
The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's take the bread.
De la misma manera, tomó en sus manos la copa de vino después de la cena y dijo, esta copa es el nuevo pacto entre Dios y su pueblo, un acuerdo confirmado con mi sangre. Hagan esto en memoria de mí todas las veces que la beban, pues cada vez que coman este pan y beban de esta copa, anuncian la muerte del Señor hasta que Él vuelva.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's remember. Lord, we thank you that we belong to you. And through the blood of Jesus Christ, there is forgiveness and there is adoption. And there is entering into your family. Thank you, Lord. You are a beautiful Savior. We worship you today as we remember, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand together. We're going to continue in worship.
Composing. Lord, would you reveal to us your heart of love for us? And Lord, would our lives be guided by an inner sense of your love and a holy fear of who you are. And we hold those two things together, spirit and in truth. As we become worshipers, as we become the types of people that you had in mind to form us into when you saved us. So church, let's sing together as we close out our time of singing today. Let's just sing this bridge. Sing holy, holy.
Sing Lord our God, Almighty.
Sing holy, every voice.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord our God.
And he is worthy of your song.
Sometimes you get the opportunity to go from the truly awesome to the mundane announcements. But we're going to do that anyway. My name is Dave Learned. I'm one of the pastors here, and just really thrilled to be able to worship together today. It's so right, isn't it, to lift our eyes and to sing what is true, that our God is holy, and to remember him through songs and communion and in a few minutes through God's word. I want to welcome all who are here, and particularly if this is not your normal thing, if you don't normally come to church here, we're really glad you're here. I've got a new friend that I've met for 2 weeks in a row who's new here, and I hope you'll meet him too. But if you're new or new-ish and trying to find your way, meet a few people, we're actually doing a thing today right after church called Discover Harvest. So it's about a half hour. You can come over here to the Hope Center, and we'll just have some refreshments and get to talk a little bit. So if that's you and you're wanting to learn a little more, come. Just drop in. We'd love to see you at Discover Harvest. For everybody, we keep in touch through our app, and we've actually got a new app as of the last couple of weeks. So I'll tell you what, I'm using it all the time, and I'm like, this is good. I like this. You got to find it through wherever you get apps. It's called Church Center. Church Center. And once you find it, you can navigate through Harvest and our campus and all that stuff. But why? Because we want to be able to communicate, because we want to be able to have prayer requests prayed for, that you can get sermon resources and giving, what's happening at the church, it's all there. So please take advantage of that. And today, we'd love to know you're here, so take a moment and check in with us. Great news, new vertical worship song released this last Friday, did you know that? Isn't that cool? It's called Build an Altar. And if you need a reminder musically of who our God is and how he works, I would commend this to you. You can get this anywhere you get music. I was listening to it driving to church today, and I was like, yes, that's what I needed to hear this morning. So praise the Lord for that. In a moment, we're going to pray for one of our local church partners. John Kelly is the pastor at Chicago West Bible Church, and John has been a part, connected to our church for many years. We are thrilled with what the Lord's doing through them, and we just want to keep praying that he would continue that work. So we're going to do that in just a moment. And our worship now is going to focus around our giving. Have you thought about the reality that our God is a generous God? He gives life, he gives strength, he gives grace, he gives salvation, he gives all that we need through all of our life. And then for those who have their faith in Jesus, he gives us a life of eternity with him. He's generous. And so the reason we are generous is a reflection of who he is and a response to what he's done in and through our lives. And so that's our opportunity and why we give. Now, how we give are some of the methods that are going to be listed on the screen, but I just don't ever want you to miss, this is a heart thing. This is a joyful response to our generous God. And so even as we continue to worship today, I hope you will just consider what the Lord would have you to do. 2 Corinthians 9 says, you will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. And so let the Lord lead you in that. We trust him, but our worship is through our giving, and you can see ways to engage in that today. So I want to pray, and then we're going to continue in worship. Lord, you are so good to us, and you are gracious, and you are generous, and to have this opportunity today is a gift from you. Thank you for reminding us of the sacrifice of your son, Jesus Christ, that I could be saved, that we could be saved. Thank you, Lord, for songs that stir our heart with what is true about who you are. Thank you for your word that teaches and encourages and challenges and corrects and instructs us, Lord. Would you please do that today? And thank you that we get to give to be a part of what you're doing. All of it, Lord, is from you. All of it is for you. So please be honored in this place today in our lives and in our church. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, in just a moment, we're going to get into our next sermon on from the book of Ecclesiastes. And we're going to just give you a moment right now just to be friendly. So stand up, turn around, find somebody, say, really glad you came to church today. To introduce you to a friend of mine. This is Jared, and Jared works with a ministry called CFR, Christian Financial Resources. One of the coolest parts about CFR is that we are partners with them. They have generously and graciously joined us together to refinance a lot of our buildings. When we were in dire straits, they came along and were really excited, in fact, to partner with us. They are excited to see Harvest have a new day, and they're investing in us in that way. And so every year we get together and we want to give them an opportunity to speak to you about what it is that they do and how you can be involved in those sorts of things. So I'm going to ask you those questions. Jared, first of all, thanks a lot for being here. He's from Milwaukee. Pleasure.
Yes.
Yeah, so not that far.
It's tropical here in comparison.
Yeah. What does CFR do? Like what is the ministry model?
Well, CFR was started in 1980 as a nonprofit financial ministry, a church extension fund. And we were started to do one thing, to fund ministry and change lives, to be able to provide a church a loan so that they could purchase land or build a facility, maybe remodel or even refinance an existing loan. And in our 44-year history, we have funded just shy of 1,000 projects. Ministry projects representing almost $1.3 billion.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
And those are big numbers, but there's a story behind every one of those numbers. And one of my favorite stories is a church outside of Peoria, Illinois. They had put up a shell of a building that was going to be their new worship center. And the plan was they would finish it as dollars and volunteer labor allowed. 12 years later, that building was still unfinished. So they reached out to a lender. We're able to get terms, but 3 weeks before closing on that loan, the lender notified them that they were going to have to change the terms in a way that did not work well for the church. They reached out to us. 3 weeks later, we closed that loan. I got to be there a few months later as they finally moved into that space after 12 years, and the sound guy came up to me and said, I found a home here. He now knows Jesus because they asked him to help as a business owner with the sound. He got to know Jesus as they finished out that new space. That's awesome. We love being a partner in ministry like that.
Yeah. Now, part of the way that it works is that people can be involved, in fact, with you. So you're not just a lender.
you are also, I don't even know what the language is, but people can actually put some of their money with you and get a really great rate of return, and that's actually kind of how you fund everything, isn't it?
Yeah, people will ask, where did you come up with the dollars to be able to make all those loans to ministries? And the answer is actually that we find our model in the example of the early church. In Acts chapter 4, we read, no one was in need among them. Why? They shared the resources that they had. We were able to come alongside and partner with Harvest because of people like you and me and churches all across the U.S. who wanted to be good stewards of what they had and invested at CFR. So every one of us in the room could partner with CFR to help other churches like Harvest. We have something called a ready access. It earns a rate of return. You also can connect that to an external bank account. You can move funds back and forth. You get a good rate of return, but also know that it's just being used to help churches. Yeah. Others of us have some resources we've set aside over time, including an old retirement account. We could put into a time certificate at CFR, get a better rate of return, and know that it's helping churches. We also have something called a giving fund. It's a donor-advised fund. It works great for people who typically give $10,000 a year to ministries like Harvest and other nonprofits that they love. It works sort of like a charitable checking account, but comes with some significant tax advantages. Here's the thing about all of those. We're not investment advisors. We're not stockbrokers. We're not helping you pick mutual funds. You know that it's good stewardship for two reasons. One, you will get a rate of return, but you also know that those dollars are only being used to help churches across the U.S.
Yeah, so we're not here for a sales pitch. We are here actually to just let you know about this really cool opportunity that every dollar that they actually make ends up going rolled back into churches like ours that are trying to pay off buildings or build in some really difficult places. This weekend, you have people at every one of our campuses, right? And they're going to be in the lobby of everywhere, and we can find out more there.
Yep, and we even if you are like real savvy with your phone, we have a QR code or a short code you can text. If you want to do that, that should come up on screen. You can send that. You'll get a link to a form. You can provide your contact info. We even have a button in the Harvest app. So if you open up the Harvest app and click on CFR, you can provide your information. But I think our people are pretty nice, so feel free to have a conversation with them after the service. They'd be happy to answer any questions that you have. They can give you something to take with you, and you can provide your contact info to them as well for us
Jared
to
said
up.
Before the service tonight when I saw him that he was kind of sad because Tommy Kreitz was not preaching. So I thought that was great, Jared. Thanks for that. Thanks for that.
Yeah, context matters, right? Context matters. But
I do want to pray for you guys.
Well, though, Jeff, thank you for hosting us. We appreciate it. Lord, thank you for preaching.
Wait till you hear the sermon. Lord, I'm so thankful for your grace and for our friends and brothers and sisters in Christ who are answering your call to do some really creative stuff. Lord, there are churches all over the place who don't have enough money to fund some of the dreams and visions that they have to hit their community with the gospel, Lord, and these dear folks are providing that. I pray, Lord, that in the years to come, there will be many, 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 many church buildings, churches that are flourishing because of the ministry of CFR. So God, would you bless them richly? Would you help us to be involved as much as we can, Lord? And we just look forward to what the growing partnership will look like in days ahead. So thank you so much for them. We ask you to bless them in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Thanks, Jared. It's great to see you, buddy.
That's good.
Yeah. Okay. It's good to see you. If you have a Bible, I want to invite you to open it to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Ecclesiastes chapter 3. We're in a series on the book of Ecclesiastes, and I'm going to summarize the basic life rule that Ecclesiastes is trying to teach us in the first couple chapters of the book. Kohelet is the name of the Hebrew way of saying the preacher. And so I'm using that language, Kohelet, as the author of what's being said here. And if you sat Kohelet down right here and I could interview him like I just interviewed Jared, if we could ask him the question, what are you trying to say? I think his answer after the first couple of chapters would be this. The projects we put our energy into rarely turn out how we want or expect.
all of the energy and sweat and toil that we put into whatever projects that we have, that amount of energy, sweat, and toil is not what we get in return when they're finished. In fact, we expect it to be the case that we get all that, but it doesn't happen. And he calls this, in Hebrew, hevel. He calls it vanity, fleeting, meaningless. And he covers all sorts of different subjects with this. He said, you want to have some examples? Well, he starts out in talking about how pleasures and comforts don't deliver. So in Ecclesiastes 2, verse 10, whatever my eyes desired, I didn't keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure. My heart found pleasure in all my toil, and this was my reward for all my toil. And then I considered all that my hands had done and the toil I expended in doing it, and behold, all of it was vanity. All the pleasure that I sought in all the different ways that you could imagine pleasure, all of it in the end was hevel. It took a lot of energy to do, and in the end, meh. It was a striving after the wind, and there was nothing to be gained under the sun. But it's not just pleasure that he looks at when he talks about this. We're picking out passages in the book of Ecclesiastes as we go along here. So we're covering every single passage in the book. But at the end of chapter 2, he tries to deal with the question, okay, maybe pleasure's not the thing that we should be after. Maybe changing the world should be what we do. You want to change the world? Yeah, I want to change the world. We should all change the world. If we change the world, then we'll get to the end and say, look at what we did, and we accomplished so much. If there's gain to be had under the sun, surely it's in that kind of thing. Ecclesiastes 2:18. I hated all my toil in which I toil under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to the man who will come after me. And who knows whether he'll be wise or a fool. I'm going to change the world. And then, of course, you get to the point where you're old enough that you're like, I'm going to hand it off. And then the next person who comes along is what? Like, seriously, if you have a particular political view, just think about the last number of years for you. You're like, yeah, Bush is the best. And then all those people are like, no, Obama's undone everything Bush did. But all the people who were into Obama were like, yeah, Obama's changing the world. And then Trump comes along, he undoes everything that Obama does. And then, yeah, Trump. And then the other people are, no, Trump. And then all of a sudden, Biden, he undoes it. Change the world, undo. Change the world, undo. Change the world, undo. Welcome to the life of hevel. Yet he'll be master of all which I toiled for and use my wisdom under the sun. It's hevel. So it doesn't matter if you're trying to seek pleasure. It doesn't matter if you're trying to make a name for yourself and be successful. It doesn't matter what you're after. Whatever it is that the project you're putting your energy into, it will rarely turn out how you want or expect. Talked to a few people in the recent couple weeks about this series, and they've been like, this is really depressing, man. And I was like, well, but it's not. Because listen, there's an upside. It's realistic, and there's an upside. So I want to talk about the upside. We're going to have to get into the downside again, but I want to emphasize the upside today in this passage in Ecclesiastes 3. We're going to go from verse 1 to verse 14. And in it, I'm going to try to ask and answer the question, how do we live in a world of this kind of futility? Okay, how should a Christian person then live knowing that most of the things that we're doing under the sun on this side of eternity will probably not turn out like we want them? So I've broken the passage down into three parts. One, it describes our experience, and second, our frustration, and third, our response. Our experience, our frustration, and our response. So here's the first of those, our experience in verses 1 to 8 of Ecclesiastes chapter 3. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. To everything turn. Do you guys know the birds? Okay, I'm really old, right? 51, and I wasn't around when that was written, but this is where they got it from. For everything there is a season. This word here, actually probably better translated in some of the other translations, an appointed time. The reason I say that is because the word means that God is selecting a time that you and I don't have control over. It is an appointed time. I'm happy with season. It's a season, but you're not the one who gets to choose the season. God gets to choose the season. For everything. He's going to give you a list in the next couple of seconds here of what we call 14 merisms. A merism is a statement where you talk about one side of a thing and then the other side of the thing and mean everything in the middle, right? So it's light and it's dark and everything in the middle. Morning and evening and everything in the middle. Alpha and Omega and everything in the middle. So he's going to give you 14 merisms that are coupled together in what we call couplets. So 7 couplets of merisms. If you know anything about Hebrew and the way the Hebrews wrote, 7 was the number of perfection, and there's a reason he does that. He's like, I am going to describe everything you're going to experience in this world in the most complete possible way that I can by talking about this extreme and that extreme, and by it, I mean all of the stuff. I mean everything. There is an appointed time and a time for every matter under heaven. So we're talking about on this side of eternity. What should you expect to happen in your life? This is beautiful, by the way. It's one of the most beautiful. People actually often have this at funerals. I've heard it in lots and lots of public settings before, usually used out of context. But one of the things I want you to hear as we're going through this is it sounds like the waves when you're reading it. Is there's an ebb and a flow to it. And that's the whole idea. He's saying there's this and then there's that. And then there's this and then there's that. And he's trying to get you the idea that there are these opposites that you will experience in life. There's a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. Like I said, you don't choose those times, yeah? God did not come to you before you were born and say, "What, are you good with like July, Jeff? I mean, is that a time you'd like to be born?" No, of course, you're born oftentimes when no one expected it. My wife... When our first child, Ethan, came along, we were living in Auckland, New Zealand, and he was what they call breech. For those of you who don't know what that means, he was upside down. So he was like, I'm not coming out the right way. I'm disobeying you and everyone else, which he's done ever since. So they said, we're going to have to schedule a cesarean section, right? You cut the stomach of my wife open and pull him out. And it's going to be scheduled on this particular day. Great. All right. He did not like that date, I guess. The Lord did not like that date because a couple of weeks prior, I'm sleeping soundly, and at 3 in the morning, I wake up, and the entire bed is wet. And the first thing I thought was, I'm going to have to apologize to my wife. I'm not kidding. And I woke up, and I was like, this hasn't happened in a long time. But then I kind of got my senses, and I noticed that she was standing on the side of the bed, and I was like, and then I said, what did you do? Like, did you drink too much? She said, no, my water broke. And, you know, in my haze, that started to connect the dots, and I was like, oh my gosh. And you know all those stupid, I always watched those movies before where the guy goes running around, and he's like throwing things in, and I'm like, give me a break, dude, it's not like that. No, it was like that. We were not prepared. I grabbed everything and I shoved it in the thing and I ran outside and I threw it in the car and she wasn't with me and then I had to run back in. What are you waiting for? And I grabbed her and put her in the car. I drove actually to the hospital, which normally was about a 20-minute drive. I got there in about 10 to 11. Like, it was 3 in the morning. I was driving so fast through Auckland. I get to the hospital. It's early, early in the morning. They put her in the gown and the little buggy and they take her off. My son Ethan was born just at 5-something in the morning. It was one of the greatest days of my life. But that suddenness, that unexpectedness, is a great illustration of how in control that we are of most of the things that happen to us in our lives. And that's what he's trying to get across here. There is a time to be born, and God picks it. There is also a time to die. And you don't pick it. My mom, she passed away by actually fainting on her way back from the bathroom, and she hit her corner of her head on the dresser, the corner of the dresser. This is the head on the corner of the dresser, and her brain bled out over the next 2 weeks. After everything was said and done and the funeral had happened, my dad was divvying up some of the different pieces that they had for her. And I remember he gave me her Bible, which was so important to me. And I opened her Bible up. There's all sorts of papers in it, you know. My mom was one of these people who kept notes and also kept everything else in that Bible, right? And in one of the pages was a list of what she was going to buy on Tuesday at the grocery store. I still have this piece of paper. My mom's writing. And I couldn't get over, while I was sitting there, that she had all these plans. Simple plans of what she was going to do in the next couple of days, and had no idea that she was going to walk from the bathroom back to her bed, faint in between, and die. I sat across just a couple of months ago when I was back in British Columbia. I sat across a dear brother of mine who was an elder of the church I was in there, who is one of the healthiest guys I'd ever known, and I sat across him as they found out that he had some terrible cancer. And he was basically going to die within the months. I've not had many opportunities to sit across the table from a man and look into the eyes of him who knows that his days are literally numbered. I mean, he was just healthy days before, right? One of the hardest things I've ever seen in my entire life was my neighbor across the street from my house in British Columbia. And one morning, they found their daughter who had frozen to death on their front porch. She'd overdosed, and she had frozen to death on the front porch. I watched from the window as this man disintegrated onto the ground in front of the ambulances as they told him that your daughter probably is not going to live. I had talked to her like the day or two before. There's a time to be born and there is a time to die. And you and I don't have any control over them at all. We don't choose when it happens. It happens to us. It is a time appointed for us. Time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. See, weeping and mourning and laughing and dancing. When I came back from I went to a Cape Mary Bible School in Austria for 3 months when I was in college, and I had just started dating my girlfriend, my wife now, just before I left. I went to Austria, traveled around for a while. I remember calling her on the phone on Easter Sunday saying, hey, I'm here. I love you. And I remember her saying, thank you. I was like, what? probably not a good sign. And I said, what, thank you? And then all of a sudden she started to tell me, I feel it, my favorite line. I tell people this all the time. She hates it when I tell this story. But she said, I just need some distance. And I was like, yeah, well, I mean, you go to India, and that would be a little bit further away, I guess. But I'm in Austria, and you're in Seattle. What are you talking about, distance? She says, well, I meant emotional distance. Fine. She dumped me. I was sad, very sad, but I kept corresponding with her by airmail at those times, because I'm old, right? So airmail. And I told her when I was going to be back, on the day I was going to be back. And I flew back, and I arrived at the Seattle International Airport, and I remember getting off the plane, and I had no idea at all whether or not she was going to be there, whether or not the dumping was a permanent thing, whatever. I had just written my heart out on email, on airmail stuff, and who knows? She wrote back. She was being sweet, but I was like, is this sweet, like, I love you and not thanks, or like, what is it? I remember walking down the jetway. I came out, and I saw this was back when you could come to the gate. I saw my family there. They were like, yay. They had actually brought out tambourines and weird things to hit gongs. Welcome home, Jeff. And at the end of the line was Jeannie wearing I could tell you exactly what she was wearing. Because as soon as my eyes got to her, I was like, well. And that began probably the next best 5 days of my life with her. And I was on cloud nine every single moment of the next several days. I was so overwhelmed with joy. It was a time to dance. It's a time to laugh. And there's a time to mourn and weep. I came out, I parked my car just the other day outside of a volleyball tournament. Well, my son parked it, actually, and we were inside, and we came back outside after the volleyball tournament. The car had been parked on the road with all the other cars, and the side of my car was missing. Apparently, someone decided to take it with them. Not, that's an overstatement, but there were massive scratches all down. In fact, there was a section that it would look like somebody had taken a saw and just cut it open and peeled it back so you could look right through the car. And I was like, what happened? Police came, hit and run, somebody got a license plate. They said, do you want to press charges? Yeah, right? What are you talking about? Yeah. So if somebody here, you're in trouble. But you've had this sort of thing happen to you. You didn't expect it at all. You walk out and all of a sudden, there it is. And you're like, oh. You get the phone call that somebody in your family is sick. A family member tells you, hey, mom's in the hospital. She fell. You don't even know what to do with that information. There is a deep grieving and mourning that goes on. And you will experience this in life. You will. You will also dance and laugh, but you will weep and mourn. It's a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. There's a whole debate about what this means. Some people think it's a financial thing. They used to use stones to count how many sheep they had. So casting away means you have fewer, and collecting them means you have more. Other people say, no, it's a military idea, because they used to do is if you went through a property and you wanted to ruin the farmland of the people you just conquered, you take stones and throw it into their fields, right? So they can't till the soil. Others argue pretty strongly that it's probably a sexual reference, which is, I don't know. You want to come cast away some stones with that? Like, that's what the way they're talking about it. But whatever, you can see the opposites, cast away and gather. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep. A time to cast away. A time to tear. A time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. Probably another reference to mourning. It's a time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What you need to know is it's not saying there's a time you're going to have to go to war. And there's going to be a time that you have to hate. What it's saying is this is what you will experience in the fallen world. If you want a description of what life is actually like, there it is. Every last one of these will be things that happen to you. We can't control when we experience them. And we can't control the fact that we will experience them. God has established moments for all of this and everything in between under heaven. Do you guys know there's a name of this book that was out? Oprah made it a big deal a number of years ago. I watch a lot of Oprah, so I know. I'm kidding. I don't watch a lot of Oprah. It's called The Secret. The book's called The Secret. I might have made reference to it before. Here's the secret story, okay? That if you want anything like you want a new car, or if you want to have a plane, or if you want to, I don't know, that girl or that boy, you have to speak it into existence. You speak it out into the universe. In the morning, you stand in front of a mirror and you say, you are confident and you are powerful and you are successful and you are beautiful. And the belief is that all of those things that you speak out, right, will end up attracting those things to you, okay? Christians in the prosperity movement do basically the same thing. They call it the law of attraction. Some people who are critical call it the name it and claim it or blab it and grab it kind of approach to things, but it's word faith. In other words, since God created the worlds and everything happened within to obedience to his word, since we're the children of God, then everything we speak will happen in obedience to our word. So, you know, I decree and declare that I will have a Lamborghini. And I say it every morning, and then eventually I'll get a Lamborghini. What's really interesting about that whole approach is it's really not new. It is a newfangled approach. Approach that is derived largely from what witch doctors did. I mean, that's all it is. It's kind of animism, paganism that says, look, if you come to the witch doctor and you give me some money, I'll give you a tool to be able to make it so that you can have your very thing. Or the person who comes to the tarot card reading and says, tell me the future so I can control it. Because if there's one thing that's consistent across all human cultures, it's that you and I want to control the future. In fact, we're desperate to do it. Like I said last week, the suburbs exist because we want to control the future. If I can have just the right lawn and just the right car and just the right house and separate myself from all of the dangers and have insurances for everything, I can control it. And a passage like this is such an affront. It's like, no, you can't. No, you can't. Faithful Christians laugh often at such approaches, right? You're gonna just speak out something and it's come back. Come on, man, that's ridiculous. We can't control the future or the world around us. We know that life has its ups and downs. Right? See, I kind of think we don't think that. The reason I think that we don't think that is, I had a friend, I think I might have shared this before. I was a student at Dallas Theological Seminary. My professor was praying at the beginning of the class, and he asked, was there a prayer request in the room? And everybody said, my aunt's foot and my rent and all these things, which are legitimate reasons to pray. But the guy next to me was a Russian guy who had lived through some of the most horrendous circumstances that I had ever heard of. And he was sitting there and he started to grin, like listening to people complain about their toenails. And so we prayed, and at the end of the prayer, he just sat there and shook his head. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, oh, you Americans, life surprises you. And I've remembered that line ever since. What, life surprises you? Yeah. We think that the way life ought to work is that everything should be, well, controllable, but if controllable, then we can actually end up fashioning things just for the positives. There is a time to dance I mean, not mourn or weep. We want the positive, gainful side of all of these comparisons. And our whole lives are given over to, I want this one. And then we're massively surprised when God does not provide for us the positive side completely. What are you doing, Lord? What? Seriously, what are you saying? What do you mean, what are you doing, Lord? The Lord's like, Ecclesiastes 3? And we're like, no, that's not the way it's supposed to work. The way it's supposed to work is all the good stuff. I blabbed it, man. I need to grab it. Or I did all the good things, or I lived the right way, or whatever, and I need to now receive the benefit of all that kind of thing. My son, when he first started playing baseball, there was a little guy on his team, Michael, and every time he got up to bat, he'd sometimes hit it, and he'd get first base or second base, and he was so happy. And then the other times, he would get up, and he would hit the ball to first base. The first base would pick it up and step on the bag. And Michael, no joke, this little guy, he would run straight through first base, right to the edge of the forest, and stand there and cry. And I remember sitting there, he did this every time he got out. And I remember saying to my wife, I don't know if baseball's for him. Because baseball is a game of failure. That's what it is. If you go into baseball thinking that you're going to somehow succeed all the time, you're in for a rude awakening, because the nature of the game is you will fail. The best players hit 3 out of 10. Some of us approach life like we're shocked that there's going to be mourning. Overwhelmed with the idea that God wouldn't just give us all the things, all the time. No, that's not how it works. It's a time to laugh, and a time to dance, and a time to weep, and a time to mourn, and a time to be born, and a time to die. Look, here's the cold truth about this life. It is a crazy roller coaster that will both make you laugh in delight and make you want to throw up. And we aren't in control of when the joy or the nausea sets in. And I find that frustrating. I find it hard to live in a world like that. I feel like it's futility to live in a world like that. If that's the way it's going to be, I should just kind of pack it in. So you see our situation here, but then he moves to describe the actual frustration. So I just said I'm frustrated. He says, yeah, you should be frustrated. Let me show you exactly why it is that you should be frustrated. What is causing the frustration in your heart? He says, what gain has the worker from his toil? And the answer is zero. I have seen the business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. This is a very kind translation that tries not to use the words the way they probably were intended. The book of Ecclesiastes, this word here, business, is actually most of the time used in the sense of burden. It's not a happy thing when he says this business. He's talking, I have seen the burden, the unhappy business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. Some translations use the word afflicted with. It's a burden that we are afflicted with. What are we talking about, the burden that we are afflicted with? Well, he has made everything beautiful in its time. Or as some translations say, it has made everything fit beautifully in its time. Like all of the stuff, the happy, the joy, the sorrows, all of the opposites, every one of them has an appointed time in your life from God, and he knows exactly how they're going to fit together in your life. But you don't. He has put eternity into man's heart. yet so that he cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. See, you and I were like, yeah, I know that there's an eternity, and I know that somehow this all fits beautifully, and I know God's got that view of it. But how? Why can't I know? I can't find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. If only I had the opportunity to see the design, right? The blueprints for my life. Let me have a look at them for just one moment so then I know how this particular thing is fitting into the overall and I'll be at peace. And not have this horrible sorrow and frustration constantly. Honestly, it is very much... When I read this, I thought, oh, man, he's talking about IKEA right here for me. And here's why. If I go out and I get the IKEA set, right? Look, I know that there are instructions. I don't understand the instructions. I think there's somebody out there who does understand the instructions. Maybe the guy who wrote it. It's got that goofy guy who I just want to punch, you know, with his dumb face. And he's doing different things. And I don't know what he's doing. So usually I'm like, this can't be that hard. Throw those away, burn them. And so I'm sitting there, and I got, you know, a little screw for the splorg, and this other one, because that's what it's always named, right? The vorm. And then I've got another one, and I'm like, I'm looking at all the pieces, and I'm like, I have no idea how this is supposed to go together. I have no idea. Somebody does. I wish they would come and show me exactly how it goes together, but in this moment, I'm livid. You and I are in that situation. Look, the Lord has all the instructions. He has them. He is fulfilling your life in such a way that he will bring it to completion according to his eternal good plan. But you don't know anything about how it fits. But it does. It fits beautifully, but we don't know. I don't know how it fits. And so we sit there cross-legged on the ground with the pieces in our hand saying, where does this go, God? Can I just get a peek? It's frustrating. So what do we do? By the way, there's a columnist in Florida a number of years ago who decided that he thought you should be able to sue God. No kidding. Here's what he said. He said you should be able to sue God for negligence. And here's why. He said, I'm not sure if he, God, or she is all that mindful of what goes on down here. An example, one of my first assignments as a newspaper reporter was to visit a church in Fort Myers, where at an Easter Sunday service, the roof caved in. Most of the congregation escaped serious injury, but the church was destroyed. The only thing left standing was a statue of Joseph, the Virgin Mary's husband. The preacher told me that he looked on the statue's survival as a sign of God's love. And had I not been a professional journalist, observing the scene in an objective manner, I would have said, hold on, pal. A sign of God's love? It sounds like the old, he beats me because he loves me line of thought. It's bogus. Because if God, in all his infinite wisdom, drops a concrete roof on his true believers but spares a bunch of modeling compound, it's time to question his priorities. If I have to be composed of plaster to gain the attention of the universe, something is bad, bad wrong. Hey, priest, I get it. You're looking for a silver lining. It's a sign that the statue's still there. Yes, but what about all the dead people? Hey, man, how does this screw and this bolt fit into that? Because it doesn't, priest. Doesn't. Man, I got to be honest. When I read that, I actually can feel his point. We may not be so brash as to sue God, but we know his feeling. How do we explain how any of this fits beautifully into God's plan? And most importantly, how do we live not knowing? Kohelet turns there, right? At the end, this is the last part. This is the response that we're supposed to have. All right. So I perceived that there is nothing better for them than to be joyful and to do good. This probably means to enjoy themselves as long as they live. Also, that everyone should eat and drink and take pleasure in all his toil. See, this is God's gift to man. So, finding happiness and enjoyment in the work itself that he gives us on a day-to-day basis, in other words, is supposed to be the focus that we have, not trying to figure out how all of it fits into some grand narrative, even though it does. Do you know the monks lived an ascetic life? That's the language that we use to describe it. It means that they did without physical things. And they believed that physical things were kind of the enemy of the non-physical things. Not every monk felt that way, but for the most part, that's really what they were driving at. There are sacred things that you do, and there are non-sacred things that you do. Sacred things usually involve prayer and meditation and Bible reading. And most of us would say, look, we're not really into the monks. We live a different lives. And yet, I got to tell you, most Christian churches have carried that mentality along. They believe that there is a sacred realm and there's a secular realm. The sacred realm is church stuff. The gathering together, the singing of the songs, the raising of the hands, the taking of communion. These are all the things where God is. These are the things that we're supposed to focus on if we want to be spiritual people. The things we're not supposed to focus on are the stuff of this earth, or that's the language that used. And by that, we mean soccer. Or we mean dance. Or we mean all the other things that our lives are, work, all those other things. See, there's sacred and then there's secular, and you should invest all your time in the sacred. Here's the problem. That's not what Kohelet says. Kohelet's basically saying, yeah, you know, you're not going to be able to figure out how everything fits beautifully in your life. You're going to be holding these pieces of this dumb puzzle, wanting to figure it out, but you can't, and it's going to drive you crazy and make you cynical and feel like you're constantly carrying a burden. So what you need to do is basically say, I know somewhere it fits beautifully, but in the meantime, I'm going to go play soccer. I'm going to take the work that the Lord has given me, the using of my hands, the relationships I developed there, the feeling of success when we make the sale, all of that. I'm going to soak those in because they're gifts from God. Not to be treated as the ultimate. They're not the ultimate. You're never going to get your full satisfaction out of the success you think you're going to get. But you'll get some, and that's a gift. I'll put it another way. There are two things that he is trying to get across. We need to, one, accept the ups and downs of life and accept the frustration of not knowing exactly how each moment fits into God's greater plan. And two, recognize and delight in every joy the Lord brings as a gift from him. Try to give you some images for that. I worked in a farming community for a while, and every time I drove to the church, which was 11 miles outside of town through a bunch of wheat fields, I would drive by a barbed wire fence, and behind it were a bunch of cows, and one of the cows, every single time I drove by, had his head stuck through the barbed wire, and he had scratches all up and down his neck, and he was trying to eat the grass that was just beyond his reach. He was obsessed with the grass. What I always found shocking is there was so much grass behind him. So much grass. And he had scrapes all up and down his neck because he was trying to reach this unreachable thing. And all you wanted to do is say to the cow, dude, turn around. You don't need to be hurt all the time. You're reaching for something you're never going to get anyway. Dude, you're striving after wind. Just turn around. God's giving you a lot of grass. You don't need to carry the massive burden trying to figure out why things are happening in your life. You don't have to. You know, that's God's work, right? Like, he's the only one who's qualified to do that. It's not something you can figure out anyway. He's the one who's building the IKEA thing. Why are you sitting there complaining about it? Why don't you just give him the pieces? Go play soccer. Go enjoy a cup of tea. Go hang out with some friends. I mean, you could sit there on the floor and shake your fist at him and say, how dare you organize it in such a way? It's not going to change the hevel on this side of eternity. You'll know in time, okay? You will. When you stand before him, he'll take his little blueprint, turn it around and say, hey, remember when you're sitting on the floor? You were right here. See that little bolt? It went in there. And now here's your beautiful splorg. It fits. It fits. I had a professor in seminary when he was teaching Ecclesiastes. He made this argument. What's the book advocating for? Man, enjoy yourself. I was like, that can't possibly be the case. And he said, no, seriously. Here's your homework assignment. I want you to go out and go to a movie. And I was like, you are the greatest teacher ever. And I didn't understand it at the time. And now I do. His argument was basically, look, you could get a really big A, and you could get a C, you could get whatever it is that you're going to get. Work hard. Enjoy the process of learning all of these things. It is a joy to study God's word. Also, see a movie. Also, look around you to the gifts that the Lord has given you, because, guys, there are so many pieces of grass in your field. Your family is there. The moments where you sit around the table with them and look at each other's eyes and remember that these are the people that God has given you. As you put food in your mouth that you like, it tastes good. You have a bicycle, you get to ride it and the wind gets to blow through your hair and you get to see the countryside and smell the smells and enjoy it. And yes, your legs will burn, but you don't have to make them burn all the time. You can pull back, but the burning will bring kind of an elation afterwards. Those are all gifts. Those are all gifts from God. You drive in a well-made car. It doesn't rattle when you drive. It turns corners well. Don't you ever smile and think, wow, this is a really cool gift from God. You love to eat good steak and not broccoli. Good steak. You love to go hiking in the meadows or on a mountaintop. And you get to see all the things around and stand on a cliff and look beyond and see the majesty of God's creation and say, oh, God, you're magnificent. You get to commit yourself to work projects and work together with other people to actually see things done and see in the littlest way technology improve the life of other people around you, or you're able to sit down and help that family member or that parent figure out how it is that they can best move forward with their kids or sort out their things. What a beautiful gift from God. He doesn't need to include you in any of that, but he did, so that you could have the joy of experiencing solutions to problems. Could sit in the sun watching baseball. And even though your team's losing, you can say, it's a lovely day for baseball. You say at the end, yeah, but okay, I'm still frustrated about why God has to do it this way. Well, I perceive that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done it so that people will fear before him, that they'll revere him, that they'll say, you're wiser than we are. You're more organized than we are. You know more than we are. When you see the diagram at the end of time, you're going to be, well, wow, you are really creative. But in the meantime, you don't need to freak out and try to pick up things that are not yours to pick up. Job spent most of his life trying to figure out why all this stuff happened to him. And at the end of a whole bunch of questions that God asks him, Job says, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Who is this that raises questions about my sovereign plan? You asked that, Lord. Therefore, I've uttered what I did not understand. And they were things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. It occurs to me that most of us are actually trying to pick up logs and carry them around that we cannot carry. And we're exhausted because we have these massive burdens of trying to figure out where it goes and how it's going to work. And what the book of Ecclesiastes is doing is inviting you to say, you don't have to care. God knows where it goes. You can get up off the floor and you can live. Our weakness in understanding God's ways is meant to move us to worship. Let God be God. Let us enjoy the gifts. Let me pray for us, Lord. I'm deeply thankful for the book of Ecclesiastes and this countercultural, almost counter-church-cultural way of viewing the world. We are sometimes so adept at pointing out all the errors of focusing too much on the delights before us, and they indeed, Father, they can lead us into idolatry. They can become things we love too much, and then we expect them to deliver things they can't. But Lord, the solution is not to abandon them. The solution is to look to you, to recognize that we live in this fallen world and we'll experience all sorts of stuff, but only you can make sense of it. And so Lord, I almost want to physically with my hands just say to you, Lord, you can have it. You can have all the things I carry, all of the burdens and questions of why it is that this has happened and where it's going and when and we're going to get there, Lord, and you can have it. It's yours. I'm going to go get some dinner. So I thank you for dinner. I thank you for the joys. Give us freedom today in Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand to our feet.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Cause your goodness is running after,
that's a good start to our week, to get into the Lord's house with his people, to get our eyes on him, to be reminded of his truth. And if you're a person who's kind of, I'm new-ish here, don't really know a lot of people, I'd like to learn a little bit, I got a couple questions, I'm going to go over to Discover Harvest, which starts in a couple minutes. It's straight through the lobby to the Hope Center. So come over, we'll be there for about 30 minutes. We'd love to connect with you. For all of us now, we go out. We only spend a little time here, and the rest of our week, we go on mission for Jesus. So as you go this week, know you are loved.